Well, good morning. Welcome again to our morning worship and prayer. And before we dive into God's Word this morning, let us prepare our hearts now as we lift it up in worship to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for today. And even now, before we worship you, would you please prepare our hearts, set our hearts right, Lord God, so that we can lift you, we can raise to you, Lord God, worship that you deserve. And so, Lord, I pray that you would remove any distraction or help us to remove any distraction so that we can focus on you at this moment, in this next several minutes, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your mercy amazes me. Under your wings, your shadow covers me. A promise of love when my heart is safely untied. Speak to me, Lord, your servant is listening. Over the noise, I hear you whispering, my hope has come, and my heart is safely untied. I found my fortress in you, and my soul is anchored with you. My resting place is in your name. To me, Lord, your servant is listening. Over the noise, I hear you whispering, my hope has come, and my heart is safely undone. Save my
Lord, we thank you for the safety that we have in you, that assurance, that confidence that we have in you. And I pray, Lord God, let that be so real and so true, even in the hearts of your people today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, today our text is in Matthew chapter 25, verse 31 to 46. So let's dive into it. It says in verse 31, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will place the sheep on his right, but the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those in his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me.' Then the righteous will answer him, saying, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty or give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?' The king will answer them, 'Truly I say to you, as you did to one of the least of these brothers, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me.' Then they will also answer saying, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you?' Then he will answer them saying, 'Truly I say to you, as you did not do to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into the eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life.'" Now, this teaching of Jesus is a part of a series of teachings in the book of Matthew about the end of age. And with all the things that are happening around today, I'm sure you've heard of people or you know of people who are so concerned about the end of age right now. So many people, you know, I've heard all over, you know, even some of my relatives, they devote a lot of time in Facebook and in YouTube listening to podcasts about when the end of the age will come. So for many at this time, a lot of people are preoccupied, concerned, and places high value on the when of the end of age. But as we can see in this teaching of Jesus and the others with it in this chapter and in the one prior to it, Jesus did not give importance to the when of the end of the age. In fact, if that was so, if it was important, he would have said it. However, he told us that what is important is not the when of the end of age, but the what and the who in the end of age. So our question today is, what is of value in eternity? And what is important to Jesus Christ? See, in this teaching, Jesus tells us that in the end, all people from all nations and all the generations will be gathered. And in that gathering, there will be a separation of the sheep and of the goats. And in the end, there will be a separation for those who belong to God and those who do not. The sheep, the goats, those who, as stated in many parts of scriptures, are followers of Jesus Christ, and those who did not follow Jesus Christ. To the sheep, Jesus gives them this beautiful welcome. Diba? He said there, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." To the goats, Jesus gives judgment. And he said, "Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels." And then, Jesus gives a description of these people. To the sheep, he said, they fed him when he was hungry. They gave him clothing when he was naked. They visited him when he was sick and when they were in prison. To which they replied, "Lord, kailan namin ginawa sa iyo yun? Hindi naman namin kayo nakita na ganun, di ba?" But Jesus told them, "Truly I say to you, as you did to what? To the one of the least of these my brothers, you did it to me." To the goats, it was the exact opposite. So what do we learn from this? Again, it's not a question of when the end will come. What is important to God is what is valuable in the kingdom of God, which is actually who are the valuable in the kingdom of God. We see from this passage, God deeply cares for the poor, the oppressed, the marginalized, and the helpless. Let me repeat that. God deeply cares for the poor, the oppressed, the marginalized, and the helpless. He cares for them so much that one, He identified Himself with them. It was like, you know, He said na parang siya yung naging thirsty or yung naging hungry or yung naging homeless or yung naging may sakit or yung naging prisoner. In fact, we see this in several passages. Now, one of them is Psalm 68. He says there, He is the Father of the fatherless. He is the defender of the widows. He is the protector of those who are lonely and hopeless. As if it was a calling card, no? Not sure if you're still familiar with them. I'm not sure if you guys are still familiar or use calling cards, no? But in a calling card, diba, you see there your name and then your title. What you do. Some say, oh, this name, and then CEO or CFO, or manager, director, professor. But for God, His name and then His title is Father to the fatherless, defender of the widows, protector of those who are lonely and homeless. You see, God cares for them so much that He identified with them. Not just that, but He said all the special care, and when we say special care, hindi lang yung emotion, but it's the actions that we do them and they are counted as done to Jesus. We do it to the poor, to the helpless, to the orphans, to the widows. But Jesus said, you're not just doing it to them, you are doing it to me. He said that, diba? Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these brothers, you did it to me. I'm reminded of a story that actually changed my perspective of helping the poor. No? One of our pastors shared this. He said he was approached one day by a poor kid, a beggar, on street clothes. And then, kita niya, nagutom na yung bata. And so, nag-abot siya ng pera. And then, the person who was with him at that time said, Pastor, ba't mo binigyan ng pera? Hindi mo ba alam na gagamitin lang yung pang-rugby yan? And then, the pastor looked at that person and said, well, I did not do it for him. I did it for my God. And it's between him and my God what he does with that money. Now, some of you might not agree with that pastor. Some of you, perhaps instead of giving cash, you would prefer to give in kind, like food. And that's okay. Some of you would like to give clothing, and that's okay as well. Some in church that I know, they even establish shelters for those who are homeless. Some would even do all you can and muster, you know, your friends and gather funds so that you can supply education for them. And let me tell you, all of that are good. All of that are good. And I want to encourage you, because Jesus even said, you didn't just do it for them. You did it to Jesus Himself. So God cares for the helpless. God cares for the poor. God cares for the marginalized. God cares for those who are not influential or those who cannot defend themselves. God cares for them so much. And as believers, since God cares for them, we ought to care for them as well. Not just with our emotions, but even with our actions. But let me just warn us, there are a few motivations available for us when we do that. One, we can do compassion ministry or helping, you know, those who are marginalized out of duty, okay? As a chore that we have to do. But we all know the limitations of that, right? We all know our tendencies. We know our heart. We know how we can be begrudging at times, especially with our chores and our duties. Like, for example, when we're doing washing our dishes or cleaning the bathroom. I mean, hindi naman lahat, di ba, masaya tayo pag ginagawa natin yun. Hindi naman lagi. Minsan minamadali pa nga natin para matapos lang. In fact, when we do it out of duty, we can either shortcut things, and there's a limit to what we do. The second motivation can be because of fear. Like, probably you've read this passage, and since you don't want to go to hell, sige, you will go help the poor. Well, if you look at it, it's also a wrong motivation. Because it's not selflessness, it is actually self-preservation. So you're not serving others, even though you are, but in effect, you are serving yourself. So you do it not out of, you know, your willingness to help them. You're doing it to avoid hell. And we know that this is wrong because the Bible is very clear. We are not saved because of our works. Paul said in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works," again, "not by works, so that no one can boast." In fact, when we look at that parable and isolate it, that teaching, diba, we might get confused that the reason why these people were welcomed by the king and considered as sheep is because they helped the poor and the marginalized, the oppressed and the helpless. But then when we look at the whole counsel of the Bible, we see that the sheep's actions were not causative of their salvation, they were evidence of their salvation. Our good deeds are not the reason why we are welcomed in the kingdom of God. They are a response because we have been welcomed to the kingdom of God. So, the legitimate motivation for us then to help the poor, the marginalized, the oppressed, and the helpless is not fear, is not out of duty, but it should be because of love. And this love is the love that springs from the gospel, God's grace. What do we mean by that? You see, I hope that when we help the poor, we help them because when we look at the poor, the oppressed, the marginalized, the helpless, it reminds us of the gospel. Because the gospel says that we too are poor, not just economically, but spiritually, because of our sins, that we are in debt of our sins, that we were considered aliens and enemies of God because of our wickedness, and that we are completely helpless to solve that dire situation. However, the gospel also says, because of God's great love for you and for me, He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, for us, that though He was rich, He became poor for us. He was born not in a posh crib, but He was born in a feeding trough of animals, not to a wealthy, influential family, but to a poor couple. He died not in, you know, the comforts of an ICU or a luxurious hospital, but He died in the most painful and humiliating way, on the cross, on which His only possession, His robe, was even taken from Him. That when He was buried not in a grand mausoleum, but He was buried in a borrowed tomb. That's why Jesus can say, when He says that He identifies with the poor, He knows what He's talking about. And again, the grand reason why He did that is so that we who are poor, who are sinners, might become rich and might become righteous, forgiven, saved, and redeemed. That even though we were enemies of God, now you and I are friends and family of God. That, my friends, I hope is the motivation that will propel us to doing what we want to do, what we are called to do, which is to help the marginalized, the poor, the oppressed, and the helpless. Let it not come from fear. I hope it will not come from duty, but let it come from God's love for us. Let the gospel be our fuel and Jesus be our sole focus. And lest we become overwhelmed, so my final thought before we pray, lest we become overwhelmed with all the poverty, the oppression, the injustice happening all around the world, even in this country, I just want to highlight what Jesus said. He said, as you did it to one of the least of these brothers, to one of the least of these brothers. See, we don't have to have the solution for all the problems in the world. What we cannot do for everyone, let's do it for one. Because when we do it for one, that matters not just to that person, that matters to Jesus Christ, and that matters in eternity. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, we are grateful that You showed us Your love by sending Your Son Jesus. Though He was rich, He experienced poverty for us, so that through His poverty, we can be made rich. And that richness is not, Lord, financial richness. It's richness in righteousness. It's richness in relationship. It's richness, Lord God, in, Lord, our relationship with You. So God, Lord, we pray, would You please, Lord, align our hearts, recalibrate our hearts. I commend my brothers and sisters to You, Lord God, because Marami sa kanila, Lord God, sobrang nag-uumapaw talaga yung desire nila na makatulong sa ibang tao. God, I pray, would you please do a realigning work, a recalibrating work that, Lord, we are not doing it, that we're not supposed to do it out of fear, out of duty, Lord, out of obligation, or any other reason other than because you've loved us and because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you would help, Lord, every brother and my sister, Lord God. We'll even lift to you, Lord God, our country. We lift up to you, Lord God, what's happening in the world. Lord, you see what is happening. And we know, Lord God, that you care so deeply for those who are poor, those who are orphans, those who are widows, Lord, those who are sick, those who are lonely, those who are depressed, those who are, Lord, at this moment, Lord, experiencing a lot of, Lord, problems. Lord, give us the right heart. Change our hearts, Lord God, to your heart. Change our eyes, Lord God, from, Lord, mere human eyes, but Lord, give us your eyes for them. So that when we see them, Lord God, we would be compassionate, yes, but we would also be moved to action. God, Lord, thank you. It is not about also being able to be the answer to everyone, but Lord, you desire for us to be an answer even to one. You did not want us, Lord God, to be super amazing in this area. You're calling us to be faithful in this area. And so, Lord, I pray, would you please give my brothers and sisters the grace to be faithful? Lord, thank you that you will even multiply, that you would even multiply whatever 5 loaves or 2 fish we have at this time, Lord. Thank you that you will multiply it in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Thank you once again for joining us today, and I hope that what we have talked about today has been so helpful for us. It's been helpful for me. I hope it has been helpful for you. And so before we go to our tasks today, our job today, our studies today, you know, our families today, I'd like to pray this prayer over us. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 to 19, this is Paul's prayer and my prayer for all of us. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that being rooted and established in love, we may have the power together with the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you and I will be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. God bless you.